Heavenly armor will enter the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. No weapon that's fashioned against us will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord, and we sing glory. The power of his blood, the battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. When your enemy presses and heart, do not fear. The battle belongs to the Lord. Take courage, my friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord.
Maybe you see.
Purer in heart, O God, help me to Thee. May I devote my life wholly to Thee. Wash Thou my wayward feet.
Beautiful day, isn't it? Be in church. Cool weather. I love the change of the seasons, don't y'all? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we humbly come before you, recognizing you as our creator and our protector. We thank you for the freedom and peace we enjoy, that we may openly worship you without fear. We thank you every day for your protection from harm that could come at us from many different ways. And Father, we need you every day. Father, thank you for so many answered prayers. And Father, we pray that you would be with many of our congregation that need you. We ask that you'd guide the hands of the doctors and nurses and caregivers of so many of our number and friends and relatives of our congregation that have had recent surgeries or health problems. And we pray for the healing that only you can provide. Father, please comfort the Vault family who lost a grandson too soon. And Father, we pray for all of those of our congregation that have lost loved ones. And we pray that they would keep their focus on the home you have prepared for us. We pray for continued good health so that we can serve you as we live our lives on this earth. And we pray that you would comfort and heal those of our number that are suffering with a disease that has been lingering. And Father, we pray for our military and our first responders. Please keep them safe and be with their families. So many have lost their lives to build our great nation, and so many have lost their lives to continue to keep us safe. And Father, we pray for those who were in the path of the hurricane this past week. We pray for the first responders that are helping those in need. Help us to know what to do to help them. Please keep them all safe. Father, we pray for all the people in Ukraine and those affected by the war in that nation. And Father, so much evil has filtered in to our great nation. We pray that you would rid our nation of these dark forces. And Father, we ask that you would awaken each one here. Give us the tools and awareness to fight the evil surrounding us. Father, we recognize that all material blessings come from you, and after our short time on this earth, we will leave these material blessings behind when we die. And we pray that we will be good stewards of these blessings and share those blessings with those in need. We ask that you care for Jerry and Bonnie as they travel to Mexico visiting our missionaries. We pray for their safety. And we pray that all people will come to know Jesus and follow his example as told to us in the Bible. Father, we pray for the elders of this congregation and that by their actions and decisions, Christianity will be spread on this earth and this congregation strengthened. And we pray for all of our deacons that do so much work. Father, please be with Joe and Ray Don and Alan as they minister with this congregation. And please stand behind Joe this morning as he delivers his message from your word. And Father, we pray for your protection for each one here in our families. We pray that as we live each day, we demonstrate that we are Christians in our actions and love for one another. Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who came to this earth and showed us how to live and then died on the cross that we would have a hope of a life with you in heaven. And this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light.
This morning I'll be reading Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 6. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing, and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry.
Let us break bread together on our knees. Let us break bread together on our knees. When I fall on my knees, with my face to the rising sun, oh Lord, mercy on me.
John chapter 20, verses 1 through 3, New American Standard Version. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb, while it was still dark, and saw the stone already taken away from the tomb. And so she ran and came to Simon Peter, and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter therefore went forth, and the other disciple, and they were going to the tomb, and the two were running together. Here we see a magnificent painting done by Swiss artist Eugene Bernand in 1898. He's done a masterful job of capturing emotions on canvas that we might expect to see on the faces of two apostles hurrying to the tomb to see if the greatest event in all of human history, Jesus Christ rising from the dead, really is true. Here is how some commentators describe the scene. With the first blush of dawn tinting the clouds, Peter and John hurry to the tomb of Christ. They've just been told by Mary Magdalene she found it empty, that Christ is risen. Her words are ringing in their ears, but their faces and their bodies reveal they're not quite sure they can believe her. John looks like he's just been awakened by someone banging on his door. He wrings his hands together anxiously. His look is one of hopeful expectation. You can almost read his mind. Could it be? Has Jesus really risen from the dead? John is the one who was with Jesus when he died on the cross, the only disciple to stay by his side to the end. And then there's Peter, the only disciple to verbally deny even knowing Jesus in his darkest hour. He presses his hand against his chest as if feeling for courage, the courage that deserted him just nights earlier. Peter looks like he's had some sleepless nights, tired, haggard, ashamed, yet hopeful. Is he thinking, "Can I say I'm sorry for what I did?" He's not sure whether he can believe the report, but like John, he wants to. They both lean forward, walking briskly, readying themselves to break into a run. John chapter 20, verses 4 through 9. And the two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first. And stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Simon Peter therefore also came, following him, and entered the tomb. And he beheld the linen wrappings lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So the other disciple who had first come to the tomb entered then also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Today, 2,000 years later, we don't have to wonder or worry if the tomb was empty. We know it to be true through God's written word. But the challenge for us today is never to become complacent about the Lord's Supper. Satan repeatedly tries all manner of lies and distractions to convince us this observance doesn't amount to anything or that we're not worthy to partake of it. Perhaps he's discouraged us to the point we feel like Peter probably did. Can Jesus forgive me for what I've done? At such times, we need to remember this passage in John. Despite having denied Jesus to his face just days prior, Peter runs to the tomb. He doesn't run away or stay away from the Lord. He runs toward the last place he knew Jesus to be. As we examine our hearts in preparation for the Lord's Supper, if we find something that shouldn't be there, this is a perfect opportunity to clear it out as we commune with Jesus. Will you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, thank you for this bread that represents the very body of Christ, which he allowed to be nailed to the cross in our stead. Help each of us resolve in our heart never to take this observance lightly, but to give it utmost importance as we focus upon Jesus' sacrifice for us. In his name we pray. Amen.
Let us drink the cup together on our knees. Let us drink the cup together on our knees. When I fall on my knees,
let's pray. Father, we thank you for this fruit of the vine that represents the precious blood Jesus shed upon the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. Thank you for your great love for us and for the continual cleansing we have as we strive to walk daily with Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
together on our knees. Let us praise God together.
If you are visiting with us today, thank you for coming our way. Please drop your visitor's card if you filled one out in the plate. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the talents and abilities you have given us to provide for our families and for the material and spiritual blessings you continually bestow upon us. Help us to be generous as we give back to you so that others might come to know Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Screen shows, it is time for the Children's Bible Hour across the street here to the AC Center. And those of us that are here, still here, let's stand and sing.
Jesus calls us o'er the tumult of our minds, long restless sea. Day by day his sweet voice soundeth, saying, Christian, follow me. Jesus calls us from the worship of the vain. Make us hear thy call. Give your
Good morning, church family, and all those who are able to join us through means of a live stream that can't be here in person. We welcome you into our services here as well. Every time we gather, we see evidence of God working in our lives and answers to prayers, and it's no less the same today. When I looked at the back of the room, when I came in and saw, and I was told maybe she could be here today, but it is exciting for us to have Janice and Don Stouter back with us this morning in our worship. So that's been a long time in coming, and a lot of prayers answered there on their behalf. I will tell you, they are hurting today as well. It's good news, bad news. It's exciting that they're here. They have a lot of things on their heart today as well. So keep them in your prayers, and Billy will say some more about that, the reasons for that at the shepherd's time. But it is so very good to have both of you back with us again. It is a prayer, what you see behind me on the screen, this verse that closes out John's first letter. It is a prayer that needs to be constantly on our lips today. No less, I suspect, did it stay on the lips of the Apostle John in his day. There are several depictions that have been made, and I really appreciate and enjoyed the depiction of John and Peter at the Lord's Supper time today. So, Don, thank you for that, leading us in that way today. But several depictions have been made through time of the Apostle John's last days, living in Ephesus, we believe, as elder or leader of the church there. And, of course, his last days were not, you know, the end of the story was not his exile on the Isle of Patmos when he received the revelation given to him by the Lord. That was not the end for him. We believe he was back in Ephesus again. And one of these pictures that is given us through history is that this old man, remember, close to 100 years of age at this point in time, well outliving a normal lifespan for that day, he would shakily get up in front of the assembly, and while all were anxiously awaiting to hear the words of wisdom from this elder statesman of the faith, he would simply say something like, "Little children, love one another." Now, we can easily believe that scenario because he says that a lot in his first letter of John, right? The first letter that we have called 1 John. He says that often in that letter. But there's another scenario that I think could easily be true as well. And that is, he could have said, as he got up to address his church family, he could have repeated this prayer that I've already mentioned. It's how he chose to close out his letter. Kind of an odd way, scholars say, because really it kind of seems like it's out of the blue, because he really doesn't say anything, if you know 1 John well, about idols in there, or prohibition of worship to idols. But he ends this way, "Dear children," or "little children, keep yourselves from idols." And I picture that being one of his main exhortations to his church family as an elder statesman of the faith, wise in his many years. By the way, I like this one as well. This picture struck me of this young man holding a Bible. And this translation is really even better than the one that you read a moment ago. "Dear children, keep away from anything that might take God's place in your heart." That's a literal, very literal translation of "keep yourselves from idols." Because what is an idol? It's something that takes God's place in our heart. Well, some of you might question the relevance of this being a need to be a constant prayer of ours today. You might feel like the two guys who were walking along by a church building one day and they see the marquee sign of the sermon that is to come the following Sunday. It says, the Ten Commandments. And one looks at the other and says, well, at least I haven't made any graven images lately. Now, aside from the fourth commandment, which of course is the Sabbath principle, you might think of this as one of the most useless principles that God issued to Moses on the mountain for us today. But hold that thought. That's what we're going to get into this morning. They say in the city of Kyoto, Japan, this is just one example, they have what's called the Temple of 1,000 Buddhas. And you might say, well, that just sounds like an exaggeration. But literally inside, there are 1,000 different statues of Buddha. And each one slightly different from any of the others. Why? You might think. And some of you are probably already ahead of me on this. The reason why is the worshiper can go in and find the one that most closely resembles himself or herself and worship that one. You see, idolatry is still alive and well today, isn't it? But a person will still protest, well, that's the Eastern religions. We understand that in certain Eastern religions, they still seemingly, at least by appearance sake, they still do a lot of things regarding what looks like worship of idolatry and images and icons and all of this, much like they did in ancient times in Israel, the Canaanite peoples did, and in the Greco-Roman world. There was a great deal of images as well. Paul testifies to that in his sermon on Mars Hill in Acts 17, because the place was filled with different images and idols. And you say, that's for most of us, now maybe Eastern religion, but for most of us, that's not our thing. We don't bow down to images. We don't have to deal with that. Well, for most of us, unfortunately, the claim that we don't worship idols is patently untrue. Now, yeah, we don't bow down to lifeless images in the same way that we think of in ancient times, even in New Testament times, which was prominent. But that doesn't mean there aren't idols all around us, and that idol worship isn't just as prominent in the 21st century life as it was in Paul's or John's day. You see, it all depends on your definition. One that really resonates today comes to us from Tim Keller and his book called Counterfeit Gods. This is an alternate, different cover than I've seen before, the copy that I have. He says this. It's really kind of three definitions in one. So notice what he says. What is an idol? Again, it's anything more important to you than God. And then he starts to get personal in this definition. Anything that absorbs your heart and imagination more than God. And then he really gets into it. Really kind of goes from preaching to meddling with this one. Anything you seek to give you what only God can give. That's an idol. By that definition, then, anything around us can easily become an idol, whether it's work, you know, pursuit of a particular goal in work, workaholism, we've come to call it, or you could turn that the other side of that, leisure time. The pursuit, all-out pursuit of leisure and all the money and time and effort that goes into that. Some people take leisure time more seriously than they do work, as far as investment of time and money and all of this. Money, or just say stuff. Did you know that that is a multi-billion-dollar industry just in our country today? an industry that didn't even exist 50 years ago. I'd say probably 45 years ago. Did not exist. And now in our country, we have in self-storage facilities over 1 billion square feet of storage space. And we pay people, like I say, billions of dollars spread out across all of us per year just for our stuff. That's crazy, isn't it? So that can become an idol easily as well. Or status, prominence, fame, or sex, or food, or drink. Again, you can almost just name it. The possibility is out there. Anything that absorbs your heart and imagination more than God. Now, when you hear another, maybe even closer to textbook definition that I'm going to tell you from Webster's dictionary, you realize we're closer to being liable to this principle than we might think. Webster's defines an idol as any image or representation. See, when you say the word that way, you really know what you're talking about, right? We say representation, but it's representation of deity. That's an idol. And just as a bonus, they throw out here the extra words, an imposter. I like that one because it's what we humans tend to do a lot. We have a tendency to set an imposter up in the place of God, making for a more tolerable stand-in, one who's more easily pleased and even controlled or maneuvered. Well, let's first locate the problem behind this principle back in its original setting, as Titus read for us a few moments ago out of Exodus 32. Isn't it ironic, and just like us human beings, that even while Moses is on the mountain communing with God, receiving these life principles, one of which prominently, the second one, is you shall not have any images, make any images of me. Right after the biggie, you shall have no other gods before me. By the way, that doesn't mean God is in a pecking order. That means God is God and that's it. There is no more. He is alone. He's not part of a hierarchy. That would indicate there's more under him, right? He is alone. Period. End of story. So isn't that ironic? Moses up there hearing this, receiving this, and at the same time, Israel is down there violating God's desire to be taken just as he is. And as I said, it's told in Exodus 32. And considering what happened to them helps us get an idea of the real sin that's involved with imaging God. Israel had gotten impatient with Moses' long absence. You know, we've got to get this show on the road. You know, we've got places to go, things to do, and where this Moses is, we don't know. We don't know what's happened to him. We don't think he's going to show, so let's move on. Basically what they're saying to Aaron. And so Aaron responds to the people's request for an image or a representation. But keep in mind, we are quick to drop the hammer on Aaron, but you have to understand what was not happening here. Aaron was not trying to create a false god. Okay? He was not trying to inject in the picture a new god. He was only trying to calm the people with a tangible, visible likeness of the one true God. We have to understand that. He even uses the covenant name for God, Yahweh. He's not trying to create idol worship. We have to understand this. But he forgets the obvious problem. It logically follows if you create an image to represent the bodily reality of a deity to be worshipped. And by the way, this deity is one who cannot be imaged in any way, because we cannot fathom what that representation should look like. It just cannot be done. It's impossible to do it. So he forgets that that could eventually lead to worship of the image as the deity itself. That was the sin. Even though the original intention was for images to be aids to worship, not the objects of worship. But you see, it's a slippery slope, right? It's a very slippery slope that Aaron started the people out on. That's not the only problem with images. Another thing is, when we emphasize certain aspects of God, what do we automatically do? We automatically de-emphasize other aspects of God, which leads to a distortion, a false witness or testimony to God. For example, Aaron fashioned an idol in the shape of what? A bull. Why? Because in the Egyptian culture, you have to understand, a bull was a symbol for power. What did Aaron know? What did the people of Israel know to this point? Their God was all-powerful. He'd shown it to them. And so that's the concept he had. They had for what? 400 plus years. They were ensconced in this idolatry of Egypt. It's all they knew. And so Aaron was just trying to create something that showed in his mind, well, this is power. And so he creates the golden calf. Clearly, God is a God of power. They knew that. But what about his holiness? You emphasize one part, you downplay another, which is why Israel could supposedly offer worship to God while having an orgy all at the same time. Remember, that was the end of the passage that Titus read. They worshiped, and then what did they do? They engaged in pagan revelry right afterwards. I mean, just jarring, one beside the other. So what Israel did was not only create a distortion, but they presented an inadequate picture of God as well. I'm sure we all have pictures of ourselves we're not proud of, right? Many folks say it's their driver's license picture, right, that you hate. In one of my older ones, my mother used to say I looked like a criminal. Now, that's probably because I had a beard at the time, which she thought was a criminal act. Anyway, when I did that, and I think it's a bad picture, my current one, because it makes me look like I'm 67 instead of 57. And by the way, the camera adds pounds too. You know that? The camera not only makes you look older, but it adds pounds to you. I really don't weigh that much, as my driver's license picture shows. So if we hate inadequate images of ourselves, think how it must pain our Father God to have us attempt to image His incomparable being. That makes sense? It hurts Him when we try and serve up any kind of image of Him, because it can't be done. Here's a question for you to think about. How would you feel if your spouse or your best friend, and that needs to be the same person, by the way, if they made a sculpture of what they wished you to look like instead of the real you, and they spent all their time gazing on that sculpture and didn't pay any attention to you, the real you, how would you feel? If we could kind of get an idea of that, we would get a feeling for how God feels when we let something serve as an imposter, a stand-in, making an inadequate representation of God. There is no way we can show him truly, because any type of image we create would be hindered by our own misunderstandings and biases. When Moses was re-summarizing these commandments in Deuteronomy chapter 4 and 5, he warned the people in verse 12 of chapter 4. The only way God revealed himself was in the Word. The Word was the vehicle through which his actions and personality are known and evaluated. We have that same Word, but we also have the living Word. We have Jesus. The only adequate image then of God today is when we live up to our model, Jesus the Christ. We're to be made, Romans 8, 29 says, in His image. God will not endure anything less. Well, that leads to another reason, Israel's action with sin. That is, God cannot be captured by anything of material origin, because to do so is to attempt to encroach on the freedom, I meant to leave it on that one, of God, who is not static and lifeless, but who is spirit, who is dynamic, always moving and always acting. When all is said and done, the sin of idolatry is it humanizes God and it deifies man. To live lives of character, we have to take God as He has been revealed to us through His Word and through Jesus. What about us in the 21st century? We certainly don't throw gold in the fire and create golden calves. We don't, as Paul said in Romans 1, exchange the truth of God for a lie and worship and serve created things rather than the Creator. Do we? I think you know the answer to that. We're not as blatant as pagans. But you know, before there can ever be metal images of God, we have our mental images, right? We want God to be a certain way that matches our way of thinking and coincides with our motives and our plans. Take Peter and the way in which he and the other disciples tried to shape God in their image by making Jesus who they wanted him to be. You understand that's what they were doing, right? They wanted a powerful King, Messiah, a political Savior. They didn't want a suffering Savior, one who was on His way to die. When Jesus predicted His death in Mark 8, this is why Peter had the gall to rebuke his Lord. And Don, you're right. It's outstanding that Peter didn't want to run as far away from the Lord as he could get. That's what I would be tending to do with all that he did, not just the denial, but all that came before that. All that he did to his Lord, I'd want to get as far away from him, I think I would, as possible. But yet I hope I would do what Peter did, what Peter showed us, by wanting to get as close to him as possible. But Peter actually rebuked him. Jesus said, "Get behind me, Satan." He said, "You're thinking of the things of men, not the things of God." The Lord knew the disciples were practicing a form of idolatry. They were trying to remake God in their image, who they wanted Him to be. The reason for trying to reshape God, one is we make Him into a more suitable image. We can excuse our character flaws. I mean, who you worship determines who you are. We'd rather God fit us than the reverse. We want a God who will rubber stamp what we want to do and who we want to be, rather than the reverse. Rather than change our lifestyle, we'd like to mold Him to ours. That's idolatry. That's the formation of an inadequate picture of God. Another reason we image God is so He'll stay put. This is the God-in-the-box mentality. Remember the woman at the well in John chapter 4? She kind of had a God-in-the-box mentality, didn't she? She thought God could be located in one place or another. And for her, the Samaritan people, where was He located? They thought He was located there on this Mount Gerizim, there in Samaria. She said, "You Jews, you think He's located in Jerusalem." Jesus said, "I'm going to tell you a secret. He's not located in any one place. He is everywhere. You cannot put Him in a box. You cannot contain God. God, as he says to her in verse 24 of that chapter, God is spirit, and anyone who approach him to worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. He can't be contained to any one place. By the way, why would we want to do that? Why would we want God to be contained to one place? Well, if he stays here in a church building, in a temple, or wherever, then all we have to worry about is keeping our appointment with him, right? We don't have to worry about all the other days of the week and what we're doing on those days. It doesn't matter, right? Because he'll either be ignorant of it or indifferent to it. He wouldn't be concerned with morals, just ritual. We all know in our hearts that is a gross distortion and misstatement about the nature and values of our holy God. He cares deeply and knows and sees what we do and say here, but as I've said so often, he wants us to live out what we say and do and experience here on Sundays through the rest of the week, Monday through Saturday. He doesn't want us to contain what we experience here. He wants it to be lived out there, every day. But maybe that thinking explains the woman's moral dilemma in John 4 when we find her. She obviously did not see God as part of her day-to-day life, home life. But God will not stay put. Solomon even realized this, and he's the one who made the great temple. In 1 Kings 8:27, he says, "The heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you. How much less this temple I've built." He made the temple, yes, to house God's presence, but yet he understood you can't contain his presence. But another final reason we try and image God is we feel we can manipulate him. Take Israel. Now, before Solomon's day, in the later days of the Judges leading up to the kingship of Saul, they used the Ark of the Covenant as a talisman. You know, that's where they believed God's presence was manifest, when in the Ark of the Covenant, particularly when it was outside of the tabernacle setting. They believed they could use it as a way to control God, to use against their enemies. 1 Samuel 4 talks about Israel's defeat by the Philistines. In verse 3, they determined the next day to use the ark to their advantage. God allowed the enemy an even greater victory than before and let them capture the ark. The message to that was clear. He's not our version of lightning in a bottle. We cannot get a grip on him. We can't predict how he'll act or try and use him for our purposes. God is the one who uses us for his purposes. It doesn't go the other way. And remember, anything that in our lives robs God of the honor and glory that rightfully belongs to him, it's an idol. Well, as we finish this up, when we try and shape God into some convenient image, that is, making him become an instrument through which we deify ourselves, idolatry leads to a loss of reverence for God. We bring God down to our level. To get back to living lives of character, it's fundamental we realize our place in the scheme of things. God's the potter. We are merely the clay. Think about this for a moment. God's greatest honor to us was to make us in his image. That was his greatest honor he could ever give us. Now turn that around. Our greatest dishonor to God is to try and remake him in ours. Does that make sense? Once we get a full grasp on God's love and mercy and justice and grace, we realize he's much too large for any single snapshot we could make or use. He cannot be represented any way except by our faithful lives as patterned after his self-portrait, Jesus. We need no other picture than him. Jesus is declared several times in Scripture as the image of God. So the good news of God's second commandment is this. If we'll take God as he is, he'll take us as we are. But even better, he will reshape us into his image, the one he's always intended us to have. Paul said it this way to the Corinthians. Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. While we continue on that journey, and it is a journey, we'll never be complete this side of eternity until we go to be with the Lord. But while we continue on this journey to be fully transformed one day into what God would have us be, let's remember John's prayer. Let's make that a regular prayer for us. Lord, keep us from idols. Lord, keep us away from anything that might take God's place in our heart. Let's make that our ceaseless prayer and live that prayer out in our day-to-day. That's the message. That's the invitation. Let's stand and sing that song.
Jesus calls us from the worship of the vain world's golden store, from each idol that would keep us saying, Christian, love me more. In our joys and in our sorrows, days of toil, love me more than thee. Jesus calls us by thy mercies, Savior, make us hear thy call. Give our hearts to thine obedience, serve and love thee best of all.
Good morning, church. Again today, again this morning, we've enjoyed together in the presence of our Lord Jesus and offering our worship to our Father above. We are blessed. I want to share with you a compliment paid to this church last week. Our guest speaker, Darrell Willis, I believe, speaking for EEM, joined us also across the street after services for lunch. And in the discussion that we had, he commented that he found in this church a spirit of unity and love for one another. He called it the feeling of family. The feeling of family. Is that not what Jesus called us to do? Indeed, we are family here, and we share a whole lot, but we are tremendously blessed. I want you to know, if you're visiting with us, we're pleased to have you here. We've recently taken a good look at and gotten to know a number of our guests who became members here, and we would invite you to consider this your church home, if indeed you're open to that. We are a tremendous family here, and we enjoy one another's presence, and I want you to know that as a compliment from someone outside this church. We are glad today to have Janice Stouter back with us.
I'm sure that Don is glad to have her back too. It's been a long time. Indeed, Janice had reason to be glad that she was able to be here today, but the other part of the message, a little heavier, that Joe alluded to earlier, was that she lost her sister yesterday. A sister died that lived in Abilene, I believe more recently, maybe in Lamarck or somewhere, but funeral will be in Abilene in time. But she lost her sister, and we want to share that with her as well. Would you pray with me now, please? Holy Father, we approach your throne at this time as we've enjoyed together this time of worship and being together. We thank you, Father, for blessing each of us in the way that you have, for blessing this church, these people, as you have. We continue, Father, to seek your guidance. We continue to seek, Father, those things that you would place more important in our lives. Help us, Father, to consider those things said this morning having to do with our being attracted elsewhere, to taking a look at other ways of life that would indeed be worship of idols. Thank you, Father, for blessing each of us in our lives, for bringing us together here as a family of people that proclaim the gospel message. Father, we ask you to guide us by your Spirit, that we might seek and that we might do those things that honor you, those things that bring glory to your name, that we might seek to do your will and achieve your purpose every day that we live in this world. Thank you, Father, for what we've enjoyed and experienced today in this assembly. These things we ask in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Troublesome times are here, filling men's hearts with fear. Freedom can all go near, built to sustain. Hunting your heart to God, safe from the chastening rod. Seek the way pilgrims trod, Christians away. Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Men will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. All of the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the skies, going where no one dies, heavenward bound. Troubles will soon ignore, happy forevermore, when we meet on that shore, free from all care. Standing up in the sky, telling this world goodbye, from when we win, we'll fly. Glory to share. Jesus is coming soon, morning with night or noon. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. Oh, the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the skies, going where no one